everyone. Today we are going to talk with Dr. Kate about applied behavior analysis. So can you start off with telling us a little bit about what applied behavior analysis is?
Sure. Applied behavior analysis, also known as ABA, is one component of a science of behavior that some people call a behavioral science, some people call behavior analysis, and mostly folks around here, we mostly call it behavior analysis. So ABA is the part of that science that goes out and tries to use it to change the world, right? And this science views behavior, human behavior and critter behavior, really, as the best way to influence behavior is by changing the environment. Okay. So we don't deny that things are going on inside the organism, although, you know, if you really make me say the rat knows something, that. But, you know, things are definitely going on inside the organisms that influence behavior. But the easiest way to change a behavior from a behavior analytic perspective is to impact the environment, to change the environment, to get the behavior change. So ABA is that part of behavior analysis.
So like reinforcements and punishments.
Yeah, reinforcement, punishments, or prompts, or, you know, making sure you're not trying to teach a dog a trick while it's just eating, after it's just eating food, you know, it's not going to be hungry. They need to learn these things when they're a little bit hungry. So things like that. Reinforcement, punishment, prompts, all kinds of stuff.
So what are some of the careers that students can go into with a background in ABA?
Well, it sort of depends on the level of degree. Mm-hmm. So somebody with just a high school education and a couple of the right classes can do something that's called a RBT, a Registered Behavior Technician. So that is somebody who goes and typically works directly with usually children, but sometimes adults, usually children who are experiencing some kind of behavioral delay. So they might be diagnosed with autism, they might have a language delay, and they actually deliver services. So this is, RBT is a job that people can get straight out of high school with a little bit of extra, or straight out of undergrad with a bachelor's degree. That is mostly working directly with kids. So, but if you get a master's,
with RBT stands for
Registered Behavior Technician. RBT,
Registered Behavior Technician.
Now, with a undergraduate degree, the right classes and supervised hours. So you have to have somebody who is certified to provide supervision. And there's a lot of hours, but you can become a board certified assistant behavior analysis. Board certified assistant behavior.
So when we see BCABA,
ABA, that's what that stands for. And these are great jobs to have. You're working with somebody who has a master's degree or a PhD, and you are delivering services, and sometimes you're helping write services for registered behavior therapists, RBTs. So you, again, with this kind of the bachelor's degree level, you are going to mostly be providing direct services to kids, sometimes adults with disabilities, sometimes aging adults, all kinds of things. Now, if you get a master's degree or a PhD in behavior analysis, you can supervise those activities, but you can also do a whole lot of other things. So one of my best friends from graduate school now has a consulting business, and he consults with Fortune 500 companies to improve their workflows, and so brings a behavioral perspective to the office. I've got really good friends who provide kind of consulting services to schools, where they help schools design their curriculum. So not just the kids with behavior problems, but also all the kids. I've got a friend who works at a zoo who is their behavior therapist for all, who looks at how the environment impacts the animals and helps deal with some of the behaviors that we see sometimes in captivated animals, captured animals. So, you know, sometimes you see the primates aren't doing some pacing or some things like that. He looks at ways to change the environment to make their behavior more natural. So really, any place you got an organism, human or critter, behaving, a behavior analyst could bring their skills to that. Now, the most common job is right now, often with kids with autism, our kids with feeding disorders. Those are probably the two most common jobs right now, but we can do anything.
So yeah, she listed zoos and businesses and school systems and special homes for individuals with developmental disabilities or feeding disorders, and virtually any career, with ranging from the just kind of minimal classes. So potentially somebody might even be able to do like a summer internship type of thing with this career, all the way up to the PhD. So what would you recommend students who are interested in this do as a student at the University of Mississippi?
There are definitely some classes they should take. They should definitely take learning, and they should take that from somebody with a behavioral kind of twist. Right now, all of us teaching learning have that twist, but you could just ask the professor on the first day or email them before and say, what kind of learning am I going to learn? You should definitely take the class Applied Behavior Analysis. Right now, that's offered generally every spring. I think that will continue.
And would you take that after taking learning?
It's not a prerequisite. I think whichever one you take first, we're going to make the other one easier.
Okay.
So either way would be fine. You know, I would love it if everybody who wound up in my ABA class already had some of the basics, but it's not how it works. So whichever one, pick one, take it first.
Okay.
If you could take them at the same time, that might be even cooler because you could be doubling up on your learning. Okay. And then the other class I think people should really consider taking is the EAB class, the EAB, Experimental Analysis of Behavior class. Now, that's not going to focus in as much on application, but it will give you a better in-depth understanding of the principles and the history of the studies that have gone through to make it so that we're effective with working with animals at the zoo or kids with autism. So I definitely take learning, ABA, and EAB. If you're interested in becoming licensed or certified at one of those levels we talked about, you might want to talk to me or some of the other faculty early so that we can help you find internship experiences where you could have supervision. And there are some available, not right so much in Oxford right now, but I am really looking to recruit somebody. So there are opportunities nearby that people could do. So if you did those things, you would be well on your way to becoming a behavior analyst. The other opportunity we have is every Memorial Day weekend, I and students from our research lab goes to a conference called the Association for Behavior Analysis International. And so every Memorial Day, I'm there.
A fun conference.
It's a really fun conference. And it's an opportunity where you get to meet people and go to a lot of different types of sessions. And if you're considering this as a career and you want to do more than just the undergrad level, which is a completely good job. It's a good job to have. But if you wanted to do more, this is where you could meet potential faculty and help you identify what grad school to go to.
So getting some networking.
And we have something called the Expo where, you know, all the schools have a poster and, you know, the faculty are trying to convince you to come to their school. So it's a really good way to learn a lot about the different opportunities out there. There's also a job fair at that every year. So this conference has not only the ABA stuff, but it has EAB, the Experimental Analysis Behavior, but then it also has that third, we call it three legs of the stool. So one is applied, one is experimental, and the other is theoretical. So there's really cool theoretical talks at this conference too.
So all sorts of super fun. And do they have to be a member of an association?
Yes, so they have to be a member in order to, well, it's cheaper to be a student member and get the student rate for registration than it is to pay the non-member rate to registration. I can't remember how much it is, but
it'll change every
year. It changes every year. It's, you know, I think the biggest cost is getting yourself to wherever the conference is. Next year is in San Diego, but who knows where it'll be after that. And, you know, feeding yourself and housing yourself while you're there.
And so if they take those classes and they want to go to a master's program or a PhD program, any special advice for those students?
Come talk to me and I'll help you identify the program that fits you your best. I'm always available.
Thank you. I think that's it.
Great.
Thank you.
No, thanks for having me.